Welcome to the 15th annual Reverend Dr. William A. Jones Memorial and Awards virtual presentation. We will now be formally greeted by the Chairman of the Board of the National Action Network, Reverend Dr. W. Franklin Richardson.
I'm delighted to greet you today on behalf of this annual Minister's Luncheon that honors William Augustus Jones. He is a aspiring hero in the history of African-American church leadership in this nation and in this New York area. He has provided a legacy of a fight for justice and equality. And so today we continue in his spirit, in the spirit of all those who fought prior to our coming about, in the spirit of Martin Luther King and in the spirit of Jesse Jackson, in the spirit of Adam Clayton Powell, in the spirit of all those legendary persons that we have honored across the years, Otis Moss Jr. and different ones who've come as part of this great legacy of pastors and ministers who have had in them an alivened and awakened justice consciousness. We hope that that spirit will continue into the future pastors, that the future pastors of our communities will always have a heart for justice and advocacy on behalf of the people we serve. And so today, on behalf of the National Action Network, I want to welcome you to this annual event in a different circumstance, but yet we want to prevail in terms of lifting up those who are the vanguards of justice. We celebrate those today who we're going to honor as people who are keeping the flame alive. We've got to pass it on from one generation to another that we might go forward. And what can we say of the gallant leadership of our president, Reverend Sharpton, who has poured his life out into the lives of others that the cause of justice would reach higher and higher. He's been a great custodian of a rich legacy. And today we come to share that legacy and celebrate its future and promise in those we honor and award today. So thank you. On behalf of the Board of Trustees, the Board of Directors of the National Action Network, our 120 chapters, people who work for us, I want to welcome you to this great event. As we gather here today and now, this week, forging our agenda as we seek to make it the agenda of this nation and of our people. God bless you, and thank you for joining us.
Ladies and gentlemen, here now is the founder and president of the National Action Network, the Reverend Al Sharpton, with our statement of purpose.
And so we celebrate him today. We celebrate each pastor across this country who is engaging in social justice. And we raise Dr. Jones up as a source of inspiration to those of us who are in the struggle, who continue the legacy of fighting for justice, continue the legacy of speaking out for the voiceless. And we are thankful that in the context of the National Action Network, we celebrate this moment and are charging ourselves to be continuing advocates for justice and equality. I'm very pleased to welcome at this moment the herald of our movement, founder and organizer, president, the Reverend Al Sharpton, who will give greetings and a statement of purpose at this time.
Thank you to our chairman, Dr. Richardson, and to all of you that have gathered and you that are watching virtually around the country. One of the things that we have done in National Action Network is we are, first of all, unashamedly a faith-based social justice organization. And my journey as an activist started under Reverend Dr. William Augustus Jones. Reverend Jones was a third generation black pastor. And Dr. Gardner C. Taylor said it took three generations to make a William Augustus Jones. He was a contemporary of Dr. King. He became the pastor of Bethany Baptist Church after going to Crozer Theological Seminary, where Dr. King went. And he brought that social gospel ministry from Philadelphia, where he was pastoring, into Brooklyn. And in Philadelphia, he was peers and worked closely with Reverend Dr. Leon Sullivan. It was Dr. Sullivan that had perfected the art of boycotting major corporations for their lack of inclusion and diversity in their corporate dealings with the black community. It was off of what Dr. Sullivan did in Philadelphia that Dr. King got the idea of making it a permanent part of his organization, SCLC. And he called the economic arm that he duplicated and emulated Dr. Sullivan's work, he called it Operation Breadbasket, which became a division of SCLC. He appointed a preacher, Reverend Bennett, in Atlanta to lead National Breadbasket, and a young seminary student in Chicago to head it in Chicago named Reverend Jesse Jackson. A year later, in 1967, he made Reverend Jackson the national director and appointed Reverend William Jones the head of the Brooklyn chapter. And when they came to New York and opened the Brooklyn chapter, I was 12, going on 13, I became the youth director of the Brooklyn chapter. About 7 months later, Dr. King was killed in Memphis, Tennessee. So I literally grew up under the wing of Dr. Jones. I would go to school, I was just going into high school, and go right to Bethany after school, and he allowed me to ride around with him and the ministers, the older ministers, Reverend Charlie Nesbitt, Reverend L.P. Taylor, and I learned at their feet how to boycott, how to march, nonviolence resistance, what that meant, Gandhi, Satyagraha. I was blessed to have sat at the feet of giants, and that's why I'm not impressed with a lot of midgets running around standing on ladders, because a lot of people look tall, but they're not standing on their own 2 feet. They're being propped up. A real giant stands from the ground up, not being propped up by ladders. And Bill Jones was that. He synthesized theology with his understanding of sociology. And he started a trail that we'd not seen in New York. You must remember that New York was not a town that was conducive to Dr. King. The last time Dr. King was in New York before his assassination was about 2 weeks before. He came to New York to install Dr. Y.T. Walker, who had been his executive director. He installed him as pastor of Canaan Baptist Church in March of 68, and Dr. King was killed 2 weeks later in Memphis. And Dr. Walker ended up being the first chairman of the board of this organization when we founded it in 1991. I remember, because I was a kid and already in Breadbasket, they threw eggs at Dr. King, talking about we didn't want that nonviolent stuff. Some of our brothers and sisters that were of a different ilk in the movement. So this was not a popular thing to be in New York, but Bill Jones made it resonate and took down A&P and Robert Hall stores and others and put blacks on the board and made them contract with black businesses, saying if we're not on the shelf at A&P, then none of your products will be on our shelves at home. And he was the one that innovated that. So in the spirit of that, when we started National Action Network, we said we would have every year the luncheon named after Dr. William Augustus Jones, Jr., who trained and mentored us in this King type of school of thought. And we've had everyone honored here. Reverend Joseph Lowry was honored. Mrs. King has been here before her passing. And the list goes on. Our last William Augustus Jones, Jr. luncheon, we honored in 2019, because of the pandemic, we didn't have a luncheon last year or a convention. But despite the ongoing pandemic, we have this virtual convention and luncheon this year. And the last one that we had in 19, we honored Zenola Clayton, who was here present at the Sheraton to receive her award, who was one of Dr. King's major fundraisers and still carrying on. We honored Reverend C.T. Vivian, who was the one that was the ferment for the Selma Montgomery movement. He came and was honored, and now he's made his transition last year during the pandemic, C.T. Vivian. And we honored Reverend Jesse Jackson, who's been suffering with Parkinson's. And to have those three giants at our last luncheon shows the caliber of people, because we take it very seriously to give a William Jones Award to people. They must be operating in the spirit that Dr. Jones represented. Somewhere I read, honor thy mother and father, that thy days, not their days, you don't honor them for them, you honor them for you. You honor your mother and father that your days will be long on the Lord, that the land that the Lord has given you. People that don't honor those that fathered them or mothered them can't be trusted. Because if you cannot be trusted by the folks that birthed you into what you're doing, then who else can trust you? Because no one else could do more for you. So as long as there is a National Action Network, and as long as there's an Al Sharpton, there will always be recognition for the father of my activism, and that's Dr. William Augustus Jones, Jr. So it is in that spirit we gather to celebrate him, as our chairman has said. And let me say, you know, the Bible does not deal in confusion, it deals in continuity. If you read the Bible, every prophet follows the era and the prophet before him or her. And he always acknowledges that. That's why prophets say, in the name of the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. They don't try to be starring. A lot of y'all is going for click clout, like you started something on your own. People that are connected are the people that deal with an eternal gospel. It was Dr. Walker, who was Dr. King's executive director and our first chairman, that when he became ill, asked Dr. W. Franklin Richardson to take over as chairman of the board, and he's served since then, one of the most eminent and well-respected ministers and pastors in the country, the Grace Baptist Church. Grace Baptist Church, that he's senior pastor, is one of the major black pulpits in the world. He also chairs the board at Virginia Union, and we do not take him nor his lineage through Dr. Walker and his mentor, Dr. Sandy Ray, for granted. You know, when my mother grew up in the South, I grew up in Brooklyn, New York, born and raised, and she said in the South, the first thing they would always ask you if a young man came to try and date your daughter is, who are your folks? So I've learned that in ministry. When I meet people that say I'm an activist or minister, I ask them, well, who are your folks? Who mentored you? Who'd you study under? Because it tells you a lot about what the fruit is if you know what the root is. So we're rooted in Jonesism, and this is a luncheon to celebrate him and those that operate in his spirit. Thank you. Let us go forward.
Let's show our president some love. Needless to say that the journey of Al Sharpton is reflective of exactly what he just talked about. It is a journey where he was nurtured in the legacy of civil rights and has built upon it a marvelous platform that has called us all to this moment. I'm pleased to have this opportunity to present our keynote speaker for this hour. He is a young man who is one of the greatest voices in the black pulpit today. He pastors one of the great churches, and it has even become greater under his leadership. He is extremely prepared. He's a graduate, having earned a doctor's degree from Duke University, and is currently in the only existing PhD program in preaching. He's pastor of the Alfred Street Church, which is worldwide acclaimed. He has a heart and sensitivity for social justice. He cares about the next generation. His church is one of the most generous to college students and to historically black colleges. Under his leadership, the Alfred Street Church gave over $1 million in building the African American Museum in the Smithsonian Institute. He is sought after all over the world. I want you to know I'm proud to be associated with him. I've known him for years. He's like a son to me. And I'm grateful to God that he had the opportunity to be available today to come and present virtually his the gospel for this moment. He is an outstanding brother. Many of you already know him. He's an activist. He's engaged in social justice. And he's involved in many, many very important events. He will present himself as he delivers this keynote address for the 2021 William Augustus Jones Jr. Memorial Event. Let us receive Dr. Wesley.
Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome Vi Higginson's Sing Harlem Choir as they perform I'll Rise Up.
Broken down and tired of living life on a merry-go-round, and you can't find the fighter, but I see it in you, so we gon' walk it out and move mountains. We gon' walk it out. Silence isn't quiet, and it feels like it's getting hard to breathe. And I know you feel like dying, but I promise we'll bring the world to its feet and move mountains, bring it to its feet, move. Again.
Once again, please welcome our chairman, the Reverend Dr. W. Franklin Richardson, as he introduces our keynote speaker.
I'm honored to present our guest speaker today, our keynote speaker. He's a young man that I've known from the earliest times of his ministry. I've known his father as a partner in my ministry. And I'm privileged today to have him to come and speak in this powerful arena of social justice that is the National Action Network. He fits here in this space because he has made his ministry an instrument of advocacy. He has brought innovation and creativity to the Alfred Street Church where he serves as senior pastor. He's been a voice for justice, not only in the sermons, but in writings and in engagement and in speaking and in the actions of his congregation to help liberate and continue the liberation of our people. He's a young man that is extremely prepared for this hour. He's a graduate of Duke University and currently working on a PhD in preaching, one of the only PhD programs in the country. I found him to be a special brother, and I'm sure that when you hear him today, you will be blessed and inspired. He'll speak for himself, but I'm proud to speak for him. He is as a son to me, the Reverend Dr. Howard John Wesley, senior pastor of the Alfred Street Church in the city of Alexandria, Virginia.
Beloved, grace and peace be unto you from God who loves us as a father and a mother, and Jesus Christ, who alone is our resurrected, our risen, our reigning, and our returning Redeemer. I'm Pastor Howard John Wesley, right here in the heart of Alfred Street Baptist Church in Alexandria, Virginia. And I want to pause along with thousands across this land and give thanks to God for the 30th anniversary of the National Action Network. For 30 years, this National Action Network and the voice of the Reverend Dr. Al Sharpton has been our Ezekiel on our watchtower, sharing with us the dangers that are coming across this land and advocating for racial justice and equality. How necessary the National Action Network is, even in a day like this, when we're dealing with yet another murder of a young black man, Daunte Wright, at the hands of another police officer. The work is not done. Dr. Sharpton, may God give you strength to stand faithful to this assignment. I'm blessed tonight to be able to share with you in this honoring and celebrating of a voice that is synonymous with prophetic preaching, the Dr. William Augustus Jones. And tonight, as we gather in this space and begin to talk about the black church, I want to share with you a sermon God placed in my heart from Matthew chapter 17, when Jesus takes Peter, James, and John to the top of a mountain. And as we examine that passage, I'd like to share with you today what's wrong with the church. My prayer is that you're blessed, that we're transformed, that we continue to be faithful in our assignment. What's wrong with the church? If you were turning your Bibles with me to the Gospel of Matthew, Matthew chapter 17, when reading, you're hearing out of the New International Version, beginning in verse number 1. Matthew chapter 17, beginning in verse number 1. After 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John, the brother of James, and led them up a high mountain by themselves. There he was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became as white as the light. Just then there appeared before them Moses and Elijah talking with Jesus. Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I will put up 3 shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." And while he was still speaking, a bright cloud covered them, and a voice from the cloud said, "This is my son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him." When the disciples heard, they fell face down to the ground, terrified. But Jesus came and touched them. "Get up," he said. "Don't be afraid." And when they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus. And as they were coming down the mountain, Jesus instructed them, Don't tell anyone what you've seen until the Son of Man has been raised from the dead. As we hear that word of God from Matthew chapter 17, I want to preach, teach, and talk to you about what's wrong with the church. What's wrong with the church? The Bible says that after being there for 6 days, he decides to go to the top of a mountain. When you do your research, it's Mount Tabor. And it is there that Jesus takes Peter, James, and John with him. And while he's on the mountaintop of Tabor, something happens that scholars still can't really understand. The Bible says that Jesus is transfigured. In the Greek, it's the term metamorphomai, from where we get metamorphosis. And all we know is that somehow, some way, the inner glory of Jesus shines like a light, and Peter, James, and John see it. And not only do they see it, but as a result of this glory, the Bible says that Moses and Elijah show up. On Mount Tabor, Peter, James, John, Jesus, Moses, and Elijah. It is a glorious setting. And when Peter sees the glory of Christ, and Peter recognizes Moses and Elijah, here's what Peter says: Lord, it's good for us to be here. As a matter of fact, I got an idea, Jesus. Let me build 3 shelters, one for Moses, one for Elijah, and one for you. The word shelter that is used there is this Greek word skene, which is the Greek translation of tabernacle. So what Peter literally says is, Lord, let me build 3 tabernacles on this mountain. Lord, let me build 3 churches right here. Let me build 3 houses of worship right here. One we're going to call Mount Moses. One we're going to call Mount Elijah. One we're going to call Mount Jesus. Lord, let me build 3 tabernacles on this mountain. Although it's not written in the Bible, James and John seem to be going along with it. James and John quote the gospel of Dion Cole. They just say, slap, slap. Come on, you watched this slap. Sounds like a plan. They all agree it's a good idea to build 3 tabernacles on Mount Tabor in the place of transfiguration. And yet, the plan is never endorsed by Jesus. Jesus never says, let's build 3 churches. Jesus doesn't support it. He doesn't invest in it. He doesn't condone it. And as a result, Peter's plan fails, and 3 churches are not built on Mount Tabor. Why is it that Jesus doesn't support Peter's plan to build 3 churches? It sounds like a good idea. Slap, it's a good plan. We ought to build these churches, and yet Jesus does not endorse it. Why does Jesus fail to endorse Peter's plan to build 3 churches? Could it be that there's something wrong with Peter's plan to build a church that if we look at it today, may share with us what's wrong with the churches we worship in today? Can I just be a critic? I love the church more than anyone else, but allow me to tell you what I can't stand about church. Let me share with you why church is broken. Can I share with you why the body of Christ has not taken over the world as the Holy Spirit empowered us to do so? Let me share with you what's broken with church. You see it right here in Peter's plan. Peter is on Mount Tabor. And the Bible says that Jesus is transfigured. We don't really know what that means, but it somehow suggests that the glory of God is revealed in a way Peter has never seen before. What happens on Mount Tabor is so extraordinary that Moses is called from heaven. Elijah shows up. Look at the scene. The glory of Christ, Moses and Elijah. This is something they've never seen before. And yet, Peter speaks to Jesus like it's just something ordinary. Lord, that's pretty cool. It's good for us to be here. Let's build 3 tabernacles. Now, Douglas Hare, professor of New Testament, suggests that the problem with this is that Peter, James, and John, upon seeing the glory of Christ being transfigured and seeing the presence of Moses and hearing the voice of Elijah, they should have been trembling in fear. They should have been awed and amazed to the point of being silent. They should have been overwhelmed with the fear of the Lord. Beloved, may I suggest to you what's wrong with the church in 2020? One of the things that's wrong with the church in 2020 is that we have lost our holy reverence and our holy fear and our holy terror of the God who reigns over us. Listen, I know somebody's going to write back and push back and you're going to feel differently. That's all right. But I would suggest to you that we have made God too user-friendly. God has become too accessible. God has become too available. God has become cute. God has become cuddly. And as a result, there's a generation in church today who's lost their reverence and their fear for the Almighty God. Beloved, I suggest to you today that if we would truly walk with God in a real way, that there ought to be some fear within us. That we need a good dose of the fear of the Lord. We need some Psalm 5 that says, when I enter his presence, I bow in reverence. We need some Psalm 96, which says, worship the Lord in the splendor of holiness and tremble before the Lord God Almighty. In that old school Baptist church I was raised in, we started worship the same way every Sunday. We would quote Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 20. You ain't got to turn, I'll tell you what it says. The Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silent before him. We understood that when you worship God, there ought to be some reverence. There ought to be some fear that when you worship God, you're not coming to kick it with your boo. When you come to worship God, this is no casual, just come and hang out with the Lord like the Lord is your best friend. Worship is not some potluck barbecue where you just bring to God whatever you feel like bringing to God. I come by to tell you there ought to be something about the majesty of God that causes you to tremble. There ought to be something about the righteousness of God that makes you feel unworthy. There ought to be something about the sovereignty of God that makes you want to do more than just throw on jeans and flip-flops and come and worship God. That when you think about who God is and what God has done and how powerful God is and how sovereign God is and how gracious God is, there ought to be some fear within you, some reverence of the holiness of God. Okay, you're a little slow. Let me help you. During this pandemic, when we've been sheltered at home, I'm ashamed to tell you that I've taken up to watching daytime television. Yeah, and there's not much on daytime television worth watching. I'm not into soap operas. But Mark, I have found a judge show that I like to watch. No, not Judge Judy. No. I like that brother on TV, Greg Mathis, Judge Mathis. If you ain't watched it, there's nothing like watching Judge Mathis. Judge Mathis will get you straight. I was watching an episode and Judge Mathis walked in the courtroom and everybody stood up except this young man who was sitting down. And when Judge Mathis walked in, he said, "Young man, stand up." And as the court case went on, he looked at the young man and the way he was dressed and he said, "Young man, next time you come in my courtroom, you dress like you're coming to see me." And then the young man was answering questions and he was mumbling. And Judge Mathis said, "Young man, I need you to speak up and say, sir, when you speak to me." And then while Judge Mathis was speaking, the young man began to speak back. And Judge Mathis said, "When I'm talking, I need you to be quiet." Listen to what Judge Mathis said. He said, "When you come in my courtroom, I need you to stand up. When you're in my presence, I need you to dress up. When I talk to you, I need you to speak up. And when I'm talking back to you, I need you to shut up." Judge Mathis said, "I need you to stand up. I need you to dress up. I need you to speak up. And I need you to shut up." The young man got offended and looked at Greg Mathis and said, "Why do I have to stand up? Why do I have to dress up? Why do I have to speak up?" Why do I have to shut up? And Judge Mathis simply said this, because in my courtroom, I am sovereign. And when you recognize you're in the presence of sovereignty, you ought to stand up. You ought to dress up. You ought to speak up. And you ought to know when to show and shut up. I declare to you that when you are in the presence of the Almighty God, who is sovereign over all the earth, there ought to be some reverence in you that says, I know how to show up and dress up and speak up and shut up, because God is not just my best friend. God is not just some boo I met. God is not just some brother I'm kicking it with. He is the Almighty, the Eternal, the Sovereign, the Omnipotent God, and He demands my reverence. So maybe Jesus doesn't support the idea because there's no reverence in it. Can I push it? Peter wants to build without any reverence. And I finally began to understand why Peter has lost his reverence. Can I teach Bible? Can I tell you why there's no fear and why there's no trembling? Because when the Lord shows up and speaks, watch this. The Lord says in Matthew 17, the same thing God said in Matthew 3 at Jesus' baptism. Do your homework. The Lord repeats what He said in Matthew 3 and Matthew 17. This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. And maybe Peter says to himself, well, since I heard that before, there's nothing special about it. Okay, maybe that's not it. Maybe it's not just that he's heard it before. Maybe it's because Peter has seen Jesus do so many amazing things up to this point. By Matthew 17, he has seen Jesus heal a man with leprosy. By Matthew 17, he's seen Jesus speak a word and healing travel through the air to a centurion slave. By Matthew 17, he's seen Jesus rebuke the wind and the waves, and even the winds and the waves obeyed him. By Matthew 17, he's seen Jesus heal a paralytic man. He's seen Jesus open up blinded eyes. He's seen Jesus cast out demons. He's seen Jesus feed 5,000 people. And he's experienced Jesus giving him the power to walk on water. And so if Peter is like some of us, here's the problem. He's seen the Lord do so much that when God does something else, he's not even awed or amazed by it. He's seen God do so many wonderful things that when God does the next wonderful thing, he's not even awed or amazed by it. Beloved, I come by to tell you that God can work so many miracles in your life and do so many good things that the danger of the church is that we begin to take for granted the glory of God and the miracles of God and the working of God. You can get so accustomed to God's glory that you have the audacity to enter worship sitting on your hands and keeping your mouth closed as if what God did this week is just another ordinary thing. And I don't know who I'm preaching to today, but I want to challenge you, don't ever take the glory of God for granted, because everything God does is a miracle. Let me say that again. Everything God does is a miracle. Why is it a miracle? Because you can't do it yourself. God woke you up today like God woke you up yesterday, and that's a miracle because you couldn't do it by yourself. God kept you while you slept and slumbered, and that's a miracle because you couldn't do it by yourself. God allowed your loved ones to awaken this morning, and that's a miracle because you couldn't do it by yourself. And just because you've seen God do it time and time and time again, don't ever lose your amazement and your reverence and your awe and your gratitude for the goodness of God. Everything God does is a miracle. And maybe the problem with the church that Peter was trying to build, which is a problem in our churches today, is we make God too convenient and comfortable. We've lost our awe and our reverence. We've begun to take God for granted. Peter wants to build. And part of his problem is that he's trying to build without the presence of the Holy Spirit. Remember, the Holy Spirit does not come until Acts chapter 2. And now Peter is trying to build a church without the Holy Spirit. You should have caught that one already. Here's the problem. You're trying to build the church, but you don't have the Holy Spirit. And I want to suggest to you that the Church of Jesus Christ cannot exist outside of the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit. The Church of Jesus Christ cannot exist outside of the person, the power, the presence, and the promise of the Holy Spirit. You can build the building, but without the Holy Spirit, it's just an edifice with a cross on top. You can come to the sanctuary on the weekend, but without the Holy Spirit, it's not worship, it's just a sanctified weekend gathering. The choir can rehearse all week long, but without the Holy Spirit, they're not giving praise and worship to God, they're just singing some sanctified songs. The preacher can prepare to preach all week long, but without the Holy Spirit, it's not a sermon, it's just a motivational speech. We can have ministries left and right, but without the Holy Spirit, it doesn't witness to the glory of God. It's just some good works done on the face of the earth. The Church of Christ cannot exist without the Holy Spirit. A church without the Holy Spirit is like a car with no engine. It's like a remote control with no batteries. It's like having an iPhone but not having any cell phone service. It looks good, but it can do nothing it's been created to do. The church cannot exist without the Holy Spirit. And one of the things I think our churches need more than ever is a reinfusion of our dependence upon the Holy Spirit. A reinfusion of our dependence on the Holy Spirit. Jesus takes Peter, James, and John up on the mountain. And when you read the other gospel accounts of this event in Mark 9 and Luke 9, you'll find that when Jesus goes to the mountain, Jesus goes to pray. And when Jesus gets on the mountain to pray, read Luke 9, Peter falls asleep. Jesus is praying and Peter is sleeping. Peter has a praying problem. Just like the rest of the disciples, they've got a praying problem. I can prove it. Because when they come down off the mountain, they run up on a brother whose son has seizures. And the man, the father, has brought his son to the disciples only to find out they can't heal his son. And this is what the man says. I brought my son to your disciples and they had the look, but they didn't have the power. They had the title, but they ain't have no power. They wore the robe, but they didn't have any power. They were packed in on Sundays, but they didn't have any power. They sang Amazing Grace, but they didn't have any power. They quoted Bible, but they didn't have any power. What a shame to have the look of disciple, but have no power to change the world. Beloved, the world is looking to the followers of Jesus in this pandemic and expecting that somehow, some way, we've got power to change the world. And Jesus responds to the man, but he's really talking to the disciples. He's talking to you and me. And this is what Jesus says. The reason you don't have power is because you don't have enough prayer. Beloved, I suggest to you that the power of the Holy Spirit is directly connected to our prayer life. That the power of the Holy Spirit is the direct result of the practice of persistent prayer. That until we pray, the Holy Spirit never indwells us as she should, never empowers us as she wants to, never gifts us the way that she should. The Holy Spirit cannot enter a vessel that is not in prayer. I believe that is why in the book of Acts, the Holy Spirit comes, because the Bible says that the followers of Jesus are in the upper room and they're praying. That when the community is in prayer, the Holy Spirit comes. You know what our churches need right now? We need some good old prayer meetings. I'm talking about them good old Baptist Pentecostal prayer meetings with no agenda, no choir, no order of worship, just people gathering, falling on their knees, calling on God, because something happens when the church prays. The Bible says that the prayer of the righteous is powerful. The Bible says that when God's people called by God's name humble themselves and pray and seek God's face, that God will heal our land. We need some good old fashion prayer meetings. Now, here's the problem. Peter lacks reverence and awe. He's trying to build without the Spirit. So the question I then get to ask y'all is, upon what is Peter building if he doesn't have a fear and he doesn't have a prayer life to bring in the power? Stay with me. How is Peter trying to build if he doesn't have the prayer life and the power, and he doesn't even have the reverence and the fear of God? What is Peter building on? Go back one chapter to the conversation Peter has with Jesus. And Jesus says to Peter, "Thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church." Could it be that Peter wants to build the church because he thinks he has the power to do it? That when Jesus said, "Upon this rock I build," Peter thought Jesus was talking about him. That Peter believes, "I can be the foundation of the church." Peter believes the church can sustain itself as long as it's got me. Peter thinks he's the reason the church can exist. That he wants to build it on himself. You know what the problem with too many churches today? You want to know what that problem is? Too many Peters as pastors. We have too many women and men leading the body of Christ who have not crucified their ego for their calling. Too many leading who've not surrendered their ambition to the call of Christ to make glorious his name. Too many Peters who use the church as a platform to feed their own insecurities and stroke their own egos. Too many Peters standing in the pulpit trying to increase their followers more than they do increase the kingdom of Christ. Peter has to have his name on every flyer. Peter has to have his name called more than the name of Jesus in worship. Peter chases every camera. Peter wants to be on television. Peter wants to live like a celebrity, look like a celebrity, drive like a celebrity, live like a celebrity. Peter spends more on his wardrobe than he does feeding the hungry outside of his own church. When you invite Peter to come preach, Peter sends you a letter of what his minimum honorarium is and what seat he wants on the plane, and wants a first class ticket for his armor bearer, and wants to get picked up in a limousine, and wants to split the offering after he raises it after the sermon. Our churches are being destroyed by too many Peters. So Jesus doesn't support this Peter thing. You know why? Peter can't be a rock that the church is built on, because Peter's human. And Jesus knows Peter is about to mess up. Peter is about to fail. And the reason a church should never be built upon the personality of its pastor is because the pastor is a Peter who's going to fail. Sooner or later, his or her humanity is going to show up. Sooner or later, their sin is going to be uncovered. Sooner or later, you're going to find out he's a man just like you. She's a woman just like you. And the same way you're tempted, and the same way you struggle, and the same way you fall, they will fall. And if the church is built on Peter, when Peter falls, the church will fall. My church family knows, I've said this so many times, don't put me on a pillar. I can't do nothing but fall from there. But put me on the altar. Pray that God keep my mind humble. Pray that God pull greed out of my spirit. Pray that that sister doesn't catch my eye every Sunday. Pray that I walk right with God. Pray that God keep me in the palm of his hand. Pray for your Peter, or your Peter will destroy your church. What is the rock that the church is built on? When Jesus says that in Matthew 16, it's not the person of Peter, it's the confession Peter makes. Remember, Jesus asked the question, "Who am I?" Peter says, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus says, that's what the church will be built on. The church is built on the common confession that Jesus Christ is Lord. That's what a real church is built on. Not what you believe about women in ministry. Not how you feel about LGBTQIA. Not what you think about wearing makeup. Not how you interpret this passage or another. The church is built on the common confession that Jesus is Lord. And that's partially why the Lord doesn't endorse Peter's plan. Watch what Peter says. Jesus, let me do this. Let's build three tabernacles. One for Moses, one for Elijah, and one for you. As if to suggest that Moses and Elijah are equal to Jesus. Any church that is built on anything or anyone other than the promise, the presence, and the power of Jesus Christ will ultimately fail. Preachers, I came by to challenge you today. We are not celebrities. We are not called to be on this show or that show. We are called not to make our own name glorious, but to make glorious the name of Jesus. To share with the world that he is the way, the truth, and the life. To remind them that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that he is Lord to the glory of God the Father. There is no other name like Jesus. And if we're lifting higher the name of our Peter than our Christ, then that's not a real church. Listen, I know I'm getting myself in a whole lot of trouble, so let me go ahead and push it all the way through. Here's why Jesus doesn't support the plan. Not only because it lacks reverence, and not only because Peter doesn't have the prayer life to bring in the power of the Holy Spirit, not only because Peter's mistaken about who the church should be built on, but watch as Peter wants to build on the mountain, and on the mountain, there's only Peter, James, and John. The rest of the disciples are down in the valley. The only ones on the mountain are Peter, James, and John. Why Peter, James, and John? Those are the inner three. That's the elite disciples. That's the executive council of the disciples. So watch it. Peter wants to build in a way that only the elite will get to worship. He wants to build in a way where only Peter's and James and John's can get in. Oh, but we need a church where the Thomases can get in. We need a church where Judas has a chance to hear the good news. We need a church where the addict can come in and not be judged. We need a church where the broken can come in and be welcomed. We need a church where all of God's people are welcome to sit, not just those who are raised in church and memorize the Bible and know the third verse of the hymn. We need a church where the broken can encounter the presence of Christ. Jesus said, I can't support this plan because church at its best is not a museum where you showcase the holy. Church at its best is a rehab clinic where the addicted are delivered. Come by, I tell you, your addiction may not be mine and mine might be yours, but everybody watching has an addiction to something. Everybody needs deliverance. Everyone needs a word. None of us are perfect. The Bible says that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Everyone is a sinner, including the one watching right now. So Jesus says, I can't support a church that's only for the Peter, James, and John. Peter wants to build a church where only the elite can come. And shame on any church that caters to the elite at the expense of the needy. Shame to the church that has reserved parking and seating for the wealthy. Shame on the church where you got to look a certain way, act a certain way, dress a certain way to get in. Shame on the church that caters to celebrity and cares more about a celebrity presence than a sinner who's desiring to know Jesus Christ. Here's the problem, y'all. I'm done. Peter wants to build on that mountain because he wants to prolong the mountain moment. And the problem is that the need is in the valley. Peter, you can't stay on the mountain when the need is in the valley. Shame on the church that wants to stay on the mountain but never gets in the valley. Hunger is in the valley. Addiction is in the valley. Brokenness is in the valley. Incarceration is in the valley. HIV is in the valley. Homelessness is in the valley. It's not on the mountaintop. And our churches are being destroyed by entities and communities that say they are a mega church but won't get in the valley. You got a mega church with a minor ministry. The Lord calls us off of the mountain and into the valley. That's why I believe this pandemic, the hand of God is at work in it. Why? The tabernacles have shut down. The churches have shut down. And God is calling us off of the mountains of our Sunday's places and into the valley of the weekday pain and hurt and hunger of the people around us. Come off the mountain and let's get to work in the valley. The Lord is looking for a church that has awe and reverence of his name, that has a prayer life invoking the power of the Holy Spirit, that is not built on a Peter, but is built on a confession that Jesus is Christ. A church that is open and welcoming to all who need to experience Christ. And a church that knows that real ministry is in the valley. Help me fix what's wrong with church.
Thank you, Dr. Wesley, for that inspiring message. Now welcome back the Reverend Al Sharpton and our board member and the daughter of Reverend Dr. William A. Jones, the incomparable Mrs. Jennifer Jones Austin, for the award presentations to our honorees.
Give a hand to Dr. Howard John Wesley. He certainly had an appropriate message for this organization and in the spirit of Dr. Jones. And we were blessed by his message. Let us now, we have several honorees that we will be presenting awards to, the William Augustus Jones Award of National Action Network of 2021. Our first honoree is Reverend Dr. David Jefferson Sr. Mr. Chairman.
David Jefferson Sr. as presented on the screen for his extraordinary gifts and exceptional ability as a pastor and a pastor who has been focused, a pastor who exemplifies the quality of ministry that Howard John Wesley talked about today. He's a part of the board of directors of the National Action Network. He heads up our Newark chapter. He's involved in many, many activities, pastor of the Metropolitan Church. And today it is our pleasure to honor him and celebrate his naming of the William Augustus Jones Award.
To our president and founder, Reverend Al Sharpton, to our chairman, Dr. Franklin Richardson, and to the Jones family. I am both honored and privileged and blessed to receive this Dr. Bill Jones Award. Dr. Bill Jones, as many of us know, was an absolute pioneer. There are those who have even said that he was a man ahead of his time. Dr. Jones was a giant in the area of preaching. But not only was he a giant in the area of preaching, Dr. Jones was a general in the area of social justice and in the area of economic justice. There is no one who has transformed the borough of Brooklyn likened unto Dr. Bill Jones. I honestly do believe that because of his work and the mentoring that he has done with Reverend Al Sharpton, that Dr. Jones' spirit lives on in the work that our leader, Reverend Al Sharpton, is doing with the National Action Network today. My prayer is that we will pray for Reverend Sharpton. And not only should we pray with Reverend Sharpton, but we should also stand boldly, courageously, and very strong, that we might not see some of the things that others are trying to turn back occur in our country. This is a defining moment in our nation. This is a very turbulent time in our nation as well, when there are those who are trying to suppress the vote and block, and to a certain extent, destroy the very fabric of our democracy. If there was ever a time that we need to stand together today. I dare not even think about how things would be for the next generation and the next generation if we do not defend not only our democracy, but defend the right to vote in our nation. There are those who are ahead of our time, those who came before us, who have shed much blood and stood like Dr. Jones stood and stood like Reverend Al Sharpton is standing in order to protect voters' rights in this country. This is our moment. This is our time. We must step up and ensure the fact that we protect voters' rights in our nation. And family, I do believe that Dr. Bill Jones is amongst those cloud of witnesses who are compassing us about. He's cheering us on, saying to us, children, fight on, don't you give up, and don't you quit. I am once again honored and so humbled to be able to receive this award, honoring such a giant likened unto Dr. Bill Jones. And so I want to thank you. I want to thank the National Action Network and Reverend Al Sharpton and Dr. Franklin Richardson for thinking and for honoring and considering me today for this award. God bless you and God bless the National Action Network.
Give a hand, Dr. David Jefferson.
Over the course of his ministry, William Augustus Jones Jr. gave guidance and counsel to countless men and just a handful of women. I'm told Susan Johnson Cook was among them. I imagine he saw in her a do-what-must-be-done spirit, much like his own. For Susan Johnson Cook, Ambassador Susan Johnson Cook, or Sujay, as some of us affectionately call her, has lived and served with just that, a do-what-must-be-done spirit. Over the course of her illustrious career, Ambassador Cook has continually soared to successively higher heights, breaking barriers and shattering ceilings, and each time she has taken the community of the faithful with her. First female senior pastor in the 200-year history of the American Baptist Churches USA. First woman elected president of the Hampton University Ministers Conference. First and only woman to serve as the official chaplain of the New York Police Department. Founder of the Bronx Christian Fellowship Baptist Church, the Multi-Ethnic Center, and Moving Up Productions. Advisor to President Bill Clinton and member of the Domestic Policy Council. And United States Ambassador at Large for International Religious Freedom in the State Department for President Barack Obama, the first woman and first African American to ever hold the post. And she's had many, many other inspiring feats and endeavors along the way. Today, we present to Ambassador Susan Johnson Cook the Legacy Award for her trailblazing leadership and service. Very much like WAJ, she consistently does what must be done, and for so many.
Thank you so much to Reverend Al Sharpton, to Chairman W. Franklin Richardson, all the members of the board, and to the Jones family. It is my honor to accept the William Augustus Jones Award. It has been my pleasure to serve along with you, but to see you for your leadership, for your friendship. I want to thank you for serving, for always being there. But thank you so much for the honor of walking and having this name attached to me. Just before Dr. Jones died, I was the president of the Hampton Ministers Conference, and I honored him with a Living Legend Award. And we sat next to each other, and even though we disagreed on some things, we laughed, we shared together, and I said, I want to know the next generation of Joneses. And so it was my honor to be with Jennifer Jones and to sit at the table with you and your mother on many occasions at the luncheon. But today, I celebrate the release of God of the Ghetto, the next production of it. And thank you, Jennifer, for bringing that back to life so that the work and the words of your father will live. But because I'm here today receiving this award, it just gives me great joy and pride to say thank you. Thank you for the honor of knowing Reverend Dr. William Augustus Jones. Thank you for NAN, National Action Network, for the work you do. Thank you for vision, provision, for being there for our people, with our people. And what we have learned is if we walk together and work together, we will win together. And it doth not yet appear what we shall be, but we know we shall be like him. So thank you so much for this award, and may God bless you as you continue to do the work. God bless us as we continue to do the work. And if you look at the USA, it starts with U and an S, and that means us working together, A, for the Almighty. And that's what Dr. William Augustus Jones did. God bless you, and thank you so much again. May heaven smile upon you this Easter season, resurrection season, and beyond. God bless you.
Our next award goes to Bishop Noel Jones. Bishop Jones is a Jamaican-American minister and Pentecostal bishop. He's the senior pastor of the City of Refuge Church in Gardena, California, which has about 17,000 members and was formerly the Greater Bethany Community Church. Jones received a call to ministry at the age of 19. He has been here at National Action Network and done our Minister's Night and will be on the fireside chat with us this evening at 7 o'clock talking about what is prophetic ministry. May we honor the work he does in the Los Angeles community and around the country. No one has been more of an example and personify the ministry of the Pentecostal faith that is mixed with community service, that is blessed with the pride and joy of a black man not afraid to stand in his blackness and his holiness at the same time, than Bishop Noel Jones. And that is why we give him this William Augustus Jones Jr. Memorial Award. Bishop Noel Jones.
To the Reverend Al Sharpton, president and founder, to the Reverend Dr. W. Franklin Richardson, chairman of the board, to the respective tiers of leadership, to the regional directors and chapter leaders across the country of the National Action Network. And before I go any further, I'd like to make personal mention of my lifelong friend, the Reverend Jonathan Mosley, the National Action Network Western Regional Director. Jonathan and I have gone back so far that I just had to mention his name. We have so many stories I couldn't begin to tell you, particularly on this format. We just got to get together sometime, and Reverend Al, I'll tell you all the stories. I'm totally humbled, yet I'm flabbergasted that you would honor me with such distinction as to bestow upon me the August William Jones Award. Then for you to execute this deed on the 30th anniversary of your National Action Network really is to totally devastate me all the way to my knees. I want to say thank you. Professor Dr. Michael Moss, author of multiple books relating to the struggle and healing of the psychological debilitation of the African American, declares emphatically that we ask the wrong questions. In a discussion with him, I said, well, what are you talking about? He said, instead of asking what is wrong with us, we should ask what has happened to us as a people. I'm sure that's what he's talking about. He noted that we could never find the solution to our problem if we do not ask the right questions. When he said that, my only response at that time was, with respect to the question, what has happened to us, I told him, I'm forced to ask, who has happened to us? And the only answer I could deduce and can deduce even till today is who has happened to us is the white supremacists, rather supremacists. In the 30 years of the National Network, Action Network, we have survived the dexterity and the calculated onslaught of white supremacy. I stress survive. And if you ask me, what have we achieved over the duration of the National Action Network's existence? My answer would be survival in a white supremacist, deliberately contrived environment to dehumanize our existence without them exhibiting a trace of ignominy, not a trace of ignominy at all. So what have we achieved? We've achieved survival. The question is, have we flourished? And I think we will only flourish as a people totally when white supremacy and its systemic racism is defeated. But thanks to you, we are still in the fight. Every achievement made through blood sacrificial battles end up facing a counter-offensive by the racist status quo. It seems the better we address the issues, the more elusive they become. They simply change the color of the whitened sepulcher, but the dead men's bones are still inside. When we recently achieved the glorious recognition of the power of our vote in Georgia, Pennsylvania, Arizona, yes, a couple other states, the white supremacists revert to early derogatory 20th century Jim Crow legislation with an intent to suppress and seek to ultimately eliminate our joyful election-changing voice. We have not defeated them yet, but thank God and we thank you that we are still in the fight.
Yes.
We still have some of our Moseses who have not sold out to the riches of Egypt and are not satisfied with being called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, but are willing rather to suffer reproach with the African American people of God. So we are still in the fight.
Yes.
We have not defeated them yet, but we still have our William Augustus Joneses, theocrats, who have not subjected their theological authenticity and credulity to become minions and sycophants to world system leaders.
Yes.
So we are still in the fight. We have not defeated them yet, but we still have our William Augustus Joneses, theocrats, who will not devalue their eternal liberation theology preaching for the ephemeral recognition of bigoted hypocrites. Thanks to you, Al, we are still in the fight. We have not defeated them yet, but we still have our William Augustus Jones's theocrats who understand their voices for justice, equality, and opportunity for all transcends white supremacy in democracy, white supremacy in autocracy, white supremacy in oligarchy, white supremacy in monarchy, white supremacy in anarchy, white supremacy in socialism and communism. So we are still in the fight. One writer says, through true love, by which we sacrifice ourselves in order to live for others, we can find the solutions to such problems as we face: interracial conflict, violence, the conflict between rich and poor, the various environmental issues. So I say the love that we have for one another keeps us in the fight. So again, I want to say thanks to you, the Reverend Al Sharpton, to all the executive and members of the National Action Network for this prestigious William August Jones Award. And as I close, I just want to remind you, as I remind myself, we have not defeated them yet. But thanks to organizations like yours, we will never give up the fight. God bless America. God bless you. Thank you.
Bishop Noel Jones, give him a hand. We're still in the fight. That was beautiful, and you'll hear him tonight. He's on with us at 7, our closing fireside chat tonight. Make sure you hear. Our next honoree is a young man that has grown in the movement and the church. Civil rights advocacy is in his DNA. Reverend Dr. Otis Moss III built his ministry on community advancement and social justice activism. As senior pastor of Trinity United Church of Christ in Chicago, Dr. Moss spent the last two decades practicing and preaching a black theology that is unapologetically calling attention to the problems of mass incarceration, environmental justice, and economic inequality. His father, Reverend Dr. Otis Moss Jr., was a contemporary of Dr. King, and his mother was Dr. King's first secretary to the SCLC. He was born in the movement and remains that as he pastors one of the major churches in the country. May we award and salute in the spirit and name of Dr. William Augustus Jones, Reverend Otis Moss III.
First, giving honor to God for this moment and for this time, I want to say thank you to Reverend Al Sharpton, our prophet in residence, who has been lifting up the banner of justice and of love all across this nation, holding the mantle and that it was passed on to him from our great luminaries such as Martin Luther King Jr. and Fannie Lou Hamer, James Orange, Hosea Williams, and other amazing luminaries. We thank you for the work that you are doing nationally and globally, and how the National Action Network has become a premier voice to speak for those who have been marginalized in this nation. I also want to thank, call him the Bishop, Bishop Franklin Richardson. We thank you. You have been an absolutely powerful homiletical and also pastoral voice in this nation. Working with Reverend Sharpton, the two of you have been a dynamic duo. When I was growing up, there was a cartoon known as the Super Friends. They had the Super Twins. The twins were these two twins who had powers. And they would bump fists and they would say, "Wonder Twin Powers Activate." And they would say, "Form of an eagle," whatever it may be. "I believe that you all bump fists and you say, 'Prophetic Powers Activate,' a form of prophetic action, a form of protest for those who are on the margins of society. We thank you for the work that the two of you are doing and the entire team of the National Action Network. I am honored, deeply honored, by this award, named after one of the greatest preachers to ever live, William Augustus Jones. I grew up in the Progressive National Baptist Convention. I am a life member of the Progressive National Baptist Convention. And I remember seeing none other than William Augustus Jones at the convention when I was small. This very tall man who had the voice that seemed like the voice of God speak with such power. A combination of when he would speak was a combination of James Earl Jones and Sean Connery together. I remember when I first started in ministry in Augusta, Georgia, I would wake up at about 5:30 a.m. to catch a broadcast of Dr. William Augustus Jones. I had one of my first homiletical books entitled Responsible Preaching. That was a collection of his messages. And one message that still rings in my spirit was a message entitled It Came to Pass, where he stated that it did not come to stay, it came to pass. And he went through from Genesis to Revelation, where Scripture stated, and it came to pass. It did not come to stay, it came to pass. He said, injustice, and it came to pass. The pain and tragedy that people of African descent experience, it did not come to stay, it came to pass. And I would even add that the era of white nationalism and Trumpism and antebellum antics from those who hold on to an old abandoned Confederate ideology, it did not come to stay. It came to pass. An absolutely brilliant individual, William Augustus Jones. I am honored to receive this award named after the great icon and Bishop of Brooklyn by the name of William Augustus Jones. It was those three amazing preachers in Brooklyn, William Augustus Jones, Gardner C. Taylor, and Sandy Ray, yes, that ministers of a different generation would look to understand what it meant to hold the mantle and the call of the pastorate in one hand and the prophetic call in the other. We need scholars doing the work, lifting up the witness of these individuals. And then you moved over in the area of Harlem, and you, of course, had to recognize the power of Samuel DeWitt Proctor and Wyatt T. Walker. Oh, it was just wonderful that Progressive National Baptist Convention group that built such incredible relationships with each other, and they raised a generation of men and women in ministry who took hold of the prophetic mantle. So I thank you. I am honored and will take this award, and I'm gonna share it with everybody because it has William Augustus Jones on it, who I absolutely think, again, just an amazing human being and individual. On behalf of Trinity United Church of Christ, on behalf of the Moss family, though we cannot be with you in New York As a result of this pandemic, we say thank you. And I say to you on this day that though we are experiencing COVID-19, it didn't come to stay. It came to pass. Though we are dealing with an epidemic of COVID-16-19, it didn't come to stay. It came to pass. I look forward to connecting with you in the near future after this pandemic passes. May God bless you. May God keep you. May God hold you in God's arms. And may we collectively work together to get into some holy mischief to shake the foundations of this world. God bless.
William Augustus Jones, Jr., a servant leader following in the footsteps of our Lord and Savior, does their best work among the people. Without doubt, our next honoree, like our Lord and Savior, does her best work among the people. Dr. Lakeisha Walwyn's list of accomplishments is lengthy. She's an educator, internationally sought-after speaker, author, executive pastor, and now president of the New York Theological Seminary. Clearly, she is a force of nature, a force to be reckoned with. There's so much to say about Dr. Lakeisha Walwyn, a visionary leader. But what resonates most for me, as we honor her today, is her steadfast walk among the people, our people, particularly women and children. Not only is she a fierce advocate for women and children, creating spaces for our voices and healing and for restoration, but she is a force, using her personal journeys and experiences to be a bridge for others seeking to embrace and then move beyond their pain. Legacy is not just what you did, but who you impacted and how you changed their lives, how their lives were forever changed. Today, we honor Dr. Lakeisha Walwyn for the countless girls and women and the boys and men whose lives she has impacted by living her purpose and her calling. They have been forever changed. Thank you, Dr. Walwyn.
Good afternoon to the Reverend Al Sharpton, founder and president of the National Action Network, to the Reverend Dr. W. Franklin Richardson, board chair, to all of the national board members, family and friends of the National Action Network, and certainly to the family of the Reverend Dr. William Augustus Jones. Thank you so much for this tremendous honor. Dr. Jones was a man who lived his life based on that Matthew 25 mandate to feed those who are hungry, to give drink to those who are thirsty, to clothe those who are naked, to visit those who are in prison or in hospitals, and to show kindness to the stranger. And it is an honor to be a part of that great legacy. I was a freshman at Spelman College when my husband, then boyfriend, the Reverend Michael A. Walwyn Jr., introduced me to Dr. Jones. On our first unofficial date, he actually brought his book, God in the Ghetto, and told me that it was a must read. And 32 years later, we still continue to celebrate and honor the change that he made in his community and in our world. As the first woman president of the New York Theological Seminary, I am grateful that we continue that legacy by preparing faith and thought leaders to engage in relevant, restorative, and revolutionary ministry. So on behalf of the NYTS family, our students and alumni, faculty and staff, board members and friends, we are honored to receive this award. Thank you for honoring our legacy to do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with our God. Again, thank you, and God bless you all.
Congratulations to all of our honorees. Here now is the Manager of Religious Affairs and External Relations, Trudy Grant, to thank you and our sponsors.
Hello, I'm Trudy Grant. I'm the Manager of Religious Affairs and External Relations. thank you for joining us for our virtual celebration of the Reverend Dr. William Augustus Jones Memorial Service and Awards Ceremony. A great big congratulations to all of our honorees, and a great big thank you to our dynamic keynote speaker, the Dr. Howard John Wesley from the historic Alfred Street Baptist Church. On behalf of our founder and president, the Reverend Al Sharpton, our chairman of the board, Dr. W. Franklin Richardson, Reverend Nelson B. Rivers III, the vice president of religious affairs and external relations, and Dr. Reverend D. Vestoon, our national field director, our chapters, leaders, our members, and everybody in the NAN family. We'd like to take the opportunity to thank the sponsors, for without you, we could not do this. We thank you for trusting in us and lending your support, and knowing that we will keep our hands to the plow as we continue to do this justice work. Again, God bless you, and thank you all for joining us.
Every year when we come together for the Reverend Dr. William Augustus Jones Memorial, I struggle. I struggle to find the words to express on behalf of my family our heartfelt appreciation to Reverend Al Sharpton and Reverend Franklin Richardson for keeping the spirit and legacy of my father alive. I want to thank Bishop Noel Jones, Ambassador Susan Johnson Cook, Dr. Lakeisha Walrond, Dr. Howard John Wesley, and Dr. David Jefferson for all they do, much like in the spirit of Dr. William Augustus Jones, working and serving our people and our community. I want to thank Reverend Sharpton for all that he does, for the National Action Network and all of the leadership and the staff, the chapters, for all that they do. Everybody, every single one of you who are working day in and day out for our community and for our people. The fight has not yet been fully won, but we're hard at it. We keep at it, and we'll get there. Blessings.
Please welcome National Action Network's Vice President of Religious Affairs and External Relations and the pastor of Charity Missionary Baptist Church in North Charleston, South Carolina, the Reverend Nelson B. Rivers III, with our closing remarks.
Good afternoon, beloved, to Chairman Richardson and Reverend Al Sharpton, president and founder of our great organization. I am the Reverend Nelson B. Rivers III. I'm the vice president of religious affairs and external relations of the National Action Network. I have the high honor and great privilege of presenting the speaker, the preacher for the hour. He is one of the most acclaimed and belauded social justice prophets of our time. He is the Reverend Dr. Howard John Wesley. He is the son of the late Reverend Alvin and Dr. Helene Wesley and represents the fifth generation of Baptist preachers in his family. Dr. Wesley is the proud pastor of the historic Alfred.
I think they put the wrong tape in, but that is the Reverend Nelson B. Rivers. I want to thank Reverend Rivers, our Vice President of Religious Affairs. I want to thank, stand up, Dr. Rivers. And he is also leads our South Carolina chapter, and he out of North Charleston. Just the other day, we posted on social media how when they had done the police killing in North Charleston, we had gone down and to the spot where they had shot Walter Scott. In the back, and did a prayer. Little did we know that, as Reverend Rivers asked Reverend Pinckney, who was among the clergy that welcomed us to the community to stand, to do the prayer, and I stood on one side of him and Rivers the other. Little did we know it was only a few weeks before he would be killed as part of the Charleston Nine, as he was teaching Bible class at Mother Church, and he was killed in one of the Charleston Nine, and President Obama did his eulogy. This organization has been on the front line of all of that. As we convene today, the third day of our convention, 21, our virtual convention, The fact of the matter is that we're in the middle of frontline work now. As we went through our first day, it was the day they announced the charging of this police woman in the Brooklyn Center, Minnesota. And they charged her while we were doing the convention that day, the first day, just 2 days ago. And Ben Crump was then convening and sharing our workshop. And as we will go forward on today, 2 o'clock, Dr. Richardson will bring the next panel on through the night. And then tomorrow, all the head of national civil rights groups will be part of Measure the Movement. And then the youth has the whole afternoon with a series of invigorating panels. And then we will close tomorrow night. Then on Monday, Reverend Toon and our national field director and I will be heading to Minneapolis, because on Monday will be the closing arguments in the trial of Derek Chauvin. And the judge will charge the jury. And sometime Monday evening or Tuesday or Wednesday, the jury will come back on the murder of George Floyd. We will be there until it's over. But can't leave Minneapolis, because on Thursday at 12 noon, I will preach the eulogy of this young man that should not have died, Brother Wright. And I think that as we know 30 years in, that we're still fighting. We started National Action Network amidst the killing of Yusuf Hawkins in Bensonhurst. And here we are 30 years later with George Floyd. But as Bishop Noel Jones said, we're still in the fight. The bad news is that it's still a fight. The good news is that we're still in the fight and that we have not been defeated. Even though we can't claim victory, we can't claim defeat. We must fight on. 2 o'clock, we reconvene. You have a 15-minute break.
Check.
Pass the ball.
Yeah, she gave me one.
Good afternoon, everyone. We still need everyone to vacate the room so that it can be sanitized by the hotel staff. That is